to me, it's sickening. It's almost to the point where it makes you cry sometimes.
Why did you do it, Chief? How many of your students have been shot and killed?
63.
A half century ago, East St. Louis was an all-American city. Today, it's one of the most depressed and violent cities in the country. Prosecutors call it America's war zone. I've spent nearly a decade there investigating the school district, police, and politicians. Tonight, News 4 investigates how corruption has crippled this beaten-down community, making it harder to do almost anything, including enforcing the law. Did you commit fraud, Larry?
Negative, sir.
They are supposed to enforce the law.
Can I read the warrant to you?
But repeatedly.
Did you text criminals and warn them the police officers were coming to get them?
Police in East St. Louis and the villages surrounding
Sir, can you talk about the allegations against you?
Have been charged with committing serious crimes in the line of duty.
Mr. Halter, why were you arrested today?
I don't know.
You don't know. Well, here's your complaint. Why don't you read the criminal complaint?
It might have been for sucking your
Excuse me?
Many of them have bounced from one small town police department to another, often getting hired because of their connections to a chief or more prominent politicians who are either corrupt or conveniently choose to ignore complaints about their favored cops. Either way, the process of law enforcement is corrupted.
We're trying to keep the neighborhood safe.
4 years ago, then East St. Louis Police Chief Michael Baxton showed us how his officers were reducing crime in the city by cracking down on hot spots where they often found illegal drugs, piles of cash, and loaded guns.
The key is what?
The key is visibility, deterrent, contact with the public.
It sounded good, but months later, our investigation revealed many reasons why the department lacked credibility in the communities it served. Our review of court documents showed that one out of every four East St. Louis officers had criminal arrest records. Four were convicted of battery or assault. Even Chief Baxton had a mugshot.
Chief, I'm asking you if you can explain why you are in this mugshot.
I can't explain it.
The state's attorney at the time, Bob Hayda, told me that he had identified 15 current and former East St. Louis police officers who lacked the credibility needed to be an essential witness in criminal cases. In each case, he told East St. Louis officials in writing about the officers in question. Most of them were still on the police force, actively investigating criminal cases. We were there when a murder suspect was freed because Hayda believed the cop who failed to videotape his alleged confession lacked the credibility needed to be a key witness in the case.
We were forced, because of the police misconduct, particularly by Officer Perry, to dismiss the case. It's a tragedy. It's a tragedy for the victims, the victim survivors. It's also a tragedy for the citizens of East St. Louis.
The controversy over Baxton's management style grew when News 4 Investigates disclosed that Baxton told Illinois State Police they would no longer be automatically included in East St. Louis murder investigations. He claimed he would contact them as needed, then never asked for their help. 15 months later, the evidence in more than 50 East St. Louis murder cases sat in the state police offices untouched by the East St. Louis Police Department.
That is shameful. It's wrong. It needs to be addressed immediately.
It's a disgrace.
Annette Bowers, the mother of 25-year-old murder victim Larry Bowers, learned that the evidence in her son's case was still stored at state police offices in Collinsville and had apparently not been reviewed by East St. Louis cops for at least 15 months.
You letting murderers walk around in your city and it's sitting in the vault? What if it had been your child that was shot twice in his chest, that was cursed and left to die on the street?
Shortly after we exposed Baxton's decision on state police involvement, he bowed to pressure and invited state police to assist with all homicide investigations. But the credibility problems went much deeper than just Chief Baxton and some of his cops.
We're gonna make sure that everybody we hire has a clean record.
Back then, Anthony Tarvin was the chair of the East St. Louis Police and Fire Board. Our investigation also revealed that Tarvin had been accused of aggravated assault and battery in six different incidents during the previous two decades. He was not convicted in any of those cases.
You are on the police and fire board. Do you think that your record should disqualify you from that position?
It hasn't.
Not long after our reports, Tarvin and Baxton both resigned, even though East St. Louis Mayor Alvin Parks continued to support them.
Chief Baxton.
Yes, sir.
Baxton became the police chief in Allerton, a small village just south of East St. Louis. He had hired his son, Michael Jr., as a cop in East St. Louis. He hired him again in Allerton, and this time made him chief of detectives. In Allerton, two women accused Baxton Jr. of violating their civil rights and roughing them up physically during police investigations.
I got slammed on the hood of his police car several times.
So he was actually dragging her across the gravel.
Yes, out of her clothes.
Out of her clothes?
Yes.
She was
out of her shirt. Naked.
They also accused his father, the police chief, of failing to properly investigate those complaints.
So per my department policy and procedure, I'm not allowed to speak with you. You have to speak with the chief of police.
In Allerton, village leaders may proclaim Jesus as Lord, but criminals ran the government, so public officials are often cut a lot of slack. Last year, our investigation found the city administrator and public works director were both convicted felons who had recently served time in prison.
Mr. Halter, you're accused of a very serious crime in this criminal complaint. Can you address this?
Now, Allerton Public Safety Director Harry Halter is facing a charge of official misconduct. He also owns a tow lot that got the city's impounded vehicles and was widely accused of charging the vehicle's owners ridiculously high storage fees.
The men, women, and children that live in these struggling neighborhoods deserve credible law enforcement. We can't break the cycle of poverty. We can't break the cycle of violence. We can't give these kids some kind of chance at a future if there is no public safety.
No comment.
None of that bothered Allerton Mayor Randy McCallum, who repeatedly supported the public officials who were investigated, charged, and in some cases, convicted of crimes. But that's not surprising. Allerton's tolerance of official misconduct goes back decades.
The people here loves me. They come by to see me, they call me. They wish I was mayor.
Kelly Mobley became mayor of Allerton in 1981, serving 19 years in office. After she became mayor, her husband Jimmy got promoted to run the streets department. Federal prosecutors alleged the couple stole more than $240,000 in cash and services from the poverty-stricken village. Ms. Mobley was convicted of tax evasion and served 2 years in prison.
I think corruption is a big problem.
How do you define corruption? What is corruption?
I guess I'm going to use your word that you said, crook. And I didn't like the sound of it, but it's true. I think that we as a people that goes into things like that, I think that we think that maybe we can get away with something. I never wanted to get away with anything. I mean, once they say, you did this and you did that.
Up until that point, you were getting away with it.
But I always felt bad.
You felt bad while you were getting away with it?
Yeah.
But you kept doing it.
I know.
So you couldn't have felt too badly.
Well, I felt bad.
Her story is a lesson of the poor bowing to temptation. Mobley says when she first became mayor, she was making only $600 a month. Then, because she had access to more money and power than she ever imagined, she essentially got the keys to her own kingdom, and she quickly abused the privilege.
Because you were breaking the law, you were able to get a better quality of life.
But it was wrong.
It was wrong. No one would excuse it.
No.
But you were able to buy.
And I would want them to.
But you were able to buy nicer clothes.
Yeah.
You were able to buy a nicer car, right?
Right.
Probably nicer furniture. All those things because you were a crook.
That's what you said. You got to change that name.
But is that right?
You get the dictionary, you go in and find another word for that.
But
yeah, you're right.
But in fairness, you were a crook.
Yeah.
And it's hard to accept that.
I don't like the terminology, but you were right. You're right.
Others followed her example and also paid the price. Early this year, federal agents raided the home of then-Mayor Randy McCallum, who eventually pleaded guilty to stealing $1,000 from the village and attempting to deal crack cocaine. Just a few months after we confirmed Chief Baxton's 30-year-old felony convictions, he was caught in a federal sting operation after stealing what he thought was police evidence. A few months after what was then a still secret sting, East St. Louis rehired Baxton as police chief. 7 weeks later, Baxton pleaded guilty to theft and lying to federal agents.
Do you feel like you made a bad decision when you hired Michael Baxton?
No.
We interviewed East St. Louis Mayor Alvin Parks the day after Baxton pleaded guilty.
Mayor, you have to know how this looks on the city of East St. Louis. You hire a chief who stays here for 7 weeks.
What do you want me to do, Craig?
And then he pleads guilty to two felony counts for misconduct and theft, lying to federal agents, while he's the police chief of one community, and he lied to them while he was the police chief of your community.
Okay.
I mean,
is your job to punish us now? Are you here to crucify us? We turned the page when Mike Baxton resigned yesterday. We hired a new chief. We are here to pray with, work with, and fortify that new chief of police and the East St. Louis Police Department.
Why did you do it, Chief?
But that culture is tough to change. On the day Baxton pleaded guilty, a uniformed police officer driving a marked East St. Louis police car picked him up and drove the former chief to his car. That driver, Officer Rudy McIntosh, had been an informant for federal prosecutors during a previous criminal investigation into corruption in East St. Louis city government.
Do you really think it was appropriate? Really?
That misplaced loyalty for the former chief happened on the first full day in office for Mike Florey, the new police chief.
No, that was not an appropriate thing to do.
During the last 2 months, state police and federal agents have joined East St. Louis Police on a series of initiatives that have helped solve old murder cases and crack down on violent crime. The efforts have been so successful that they're being expanded. When we come back, the high price of a beaten down housing market and its impact on the poor. The collapse of the East St. Louis area weakened a housing market that's been dominated by slumlords and out-of-town speculators. Vacant houses seem to be everywhere. The impact on residents is often devastating. Smoke fills the sky as another fire rages in East St. Louis. The fuel for the blaze is the dry, rotted wood of abandoned houses. The kindling of countless urban infernos. A dozen families live within a block of the fire that threatens to get out of control.
Are you trying to make contact?
As firefighters put out the flames, we hear the sirens of police racing to an unrelated emergency.
Who owns those houses?
I don't know.
During the last few years alone, hundreds of vacant houses have burned in East St. Louis. And many of them still stand as charred shells, waiting to be torched again.
To me, it's sickening.
The Tanner family lives next to this mess. They bought their home 30 years ago and take good care of it. But most of the block is abandoned, and two of the vacant houses right next to them caught on fire this summer. The fire also damaged the Tanner's home.
When people come from out of town, you know, and they always ask that same question, what is this over here? It's vacant houses. I say we can't seem to get anything done.
This one has a code violation notice on it, dated last September. The owner had 10 days to repair the violations or supposedly feel the wrath of East St. Louis city officials. But that was a year ago.
Clearly they didn't fix any of it. So what does that tell you?
That nobody follows through on anything around here. I'm not surprised.
East St. Louis Regulatory Affairs Director Robert Betts says the city is overwhelmed with the problem. He says the city has suspended demolitions. Betts says budget cuts have gutted his office, which now depends on volunteers to do some of the government work.
It's almost to the point where it makes you cry sometimes. It's kind of degrading.
What was this neighborhood like when you moved in 33 years ago?
This was one of the nicest neighborhoods you could move in.
Columbus Liddell raised a family on the opposite side of the city. Now he has a half dozen vacant homes on his block alone.
It's hard to swallow. It's hard to swallow because I know I'm not the only one pay tax in East St. Louis. And at least East St. Louis could show us what they're doing with some of the money.
The city has put little effort into going after the people responsible for these properties.
The city just hired a collection agency.
That's correct.
Why didn't the city hire a collection agency years ago?
Well, we have had collection agencies in other areas. We sought it another way, and then we said, let's stop doing it the way we've been doing it.
Is that because it wasn't effective?
It wasn't as effective as we needed to be.
Ciron and Associates has been one of the biggest property owners of rundown housing in East St. Louis for more than 50 years. The family-owned slum real estate empire owns about 500 houses and vacant lots. Many of them look abandoned. But a News 4 investigation found that within the last year, the city of East St. Louis had only cited 13 of their properties for code violations.
I was desperate because I didn't have anywhere to live.
Mahogany Burns bought this house from one of the Ciron's companies. She wasn't required to have any credit, only a relatively small amount of cash up front. She bought it for nearly $30,000, about six times what the Ciron's company paid for it.
What's it been like doing business with Mr. Ciron?
It's been like hell.
The kitchen needs major repairs. A bedroom is missing a large part of the ceiling, and the roof appears rotted.
It looked like it's wet. It looked like it's gonna fall in.
The basement smells of old sewage and mold. The sheetrock is coated with what appears to be mold, and exposure to it could create health problems for her.
That's why I keep the door shut and I don't come down here.
Ms. Burns pays $400 a month, plus the property taxes, utilities, and is responsible for all repairs. The one-year agreement has a final payment of $25,935, and it's due in 7 months.
Do you think you'll ever pay off this house?
No. They know I won't. Mm-mm.
That must be hard.
It is. Because, you know, they prey on low-income people. They think they're getting a deal.
Over the last 4 years, we've interviewed other people who misunderstood their contracts with Ciron and Associates and realized too late that they got a lousy deal. The impact of that news was often heartbreaking.
I don't think there's any other way to put it except that it's predatory.
Brendan Roediger, an attorney at the St. Louis University Legal Clinic, is suing more than a dozen companies based out of the offices of Ciron and Associates for repeatedly violating housing ordinances.
What we're asking for is injunctive relief requiring that he actually get these properties up to code, and obviously damages for our clients who have had to live in houses that, quite frankly, you or I would never live in.
The county assessor has appraised Ms. Burns' house for $61,000. That's 12 times more than what Ciron paid for it. Since Ms. Burns pays the property taxes, the seemingly unfair appraisal costs her even more money. Any improvements she makes to the home will also benefit the Cirons, since it's unlikely she'll come up with the cash needed to pay off the loan, and the Cirons will remain the owners. Ms. Burns works 6 days a week just to come up with the money needed to pay for this house.
What is it like to work that hard for something and then find out that it's not what you thought that it was?
It's really hard, you know, it's disappointing because he prey on the low income. You know, I mean, you know, you can go get his list of houses, you're not gonna find anything in Belleville, you're not gonna find anything in Collinsville, you're not gonna find anything in Granite City. Everything is going to be right here in East St. Louis or Washington Park.
If you're not embarrassed by the way that you're operating these properties down here, why don't you just come out and talk with us about it?
Over the summer, we made repeated attempts to interview company founder Ed Ciron and his son John, but they refused.
I need to talk to my son.
Actually, we need to talk to you.
4 years ago, we caught up with Ed at a charity golf tournament.
Can you talk to us about how you conduct business?
Very effectively.
You got to know that these folks aren't going to pay that off.
Okay.
Seriously, don't you know,
okay.
You know that?
Okay, yes.
They are the housing market, and they've driven the rest of the market into the ground. I think it's, at this point, it's hard to imagine a way out of what Ciron has created.
The Cirons cornered much of the East St. Louis area market by supporting key politicians like longtime Allerton Mayor Callie Mobley.
Mr. Cion is my friend. He's a nice man.
Mobley admits she never cited any of the Cirons properties for code violations during her nearly 20 years in office, despite getting many complaints. The former mayor, a notorious slumlord in her own right, had a strong incentive to take it easy on the Cirons. According to records filed 7 years ago in the Mobley's bankruptcy case, they owed Ciron and Associates $217,000 for property they purchased from the land baron. Most of the Mobley's net income was used to pay off that debt.
Has that been good for the area? That it's so much under his control?
I think it's been, you know, when you look at a small area like this, I think it's been good for it because there's people that, like I said, could not afford to go to the bank or to maybe other real estates and say, well, look, I got $500, I want to put it down on, they don't have the credit, and you know what I'm saying. Sure. And I just want to be fair.
To use her words, to be fair, it's impossible to understand the deeper impact of the Ciron influence unless you examine the role of vacant house fires in the East St. Louis area. A decade ago, the Illinois Fair Plan, the insurance group for Illinois residents who can't qualify for any other insurance, stopped insuring houses in the East St. Louis area owned by the Cirons because they had so many fires and the insurance group's payouts to the Cirons were so high. That means residents who live in Ciron homes can't get fire insurance either.
Apparently, you did admit that your properties have an unusually high number of fires.
Numbers speak for themselves. Do we have a lot of losses? Certainly. Do we evict people that don't pay? Yes, sir. Do some of them have fires that just happened? Yes, sir. Now, do we go out and put the finger on anyone? No, sir.
If you weren't living here?
I'd be homeless.
You would be homeless?
Yes.
This is your last stop?
Yes.
Following our recent stories about slumlords and speculators, prosecutors ordered 24 landowners, including the Cirons, to fix up their property. If they refuse, prosecutors are prepared to pursue possible criminal charges against them. When we come back, strip clubs and much more, the impact of a local economy driven by vice. Strip clubs, food marts charged with selling illegal synthetic drugs, and overnight nightclubs with histories of violence. Those are usually the kind of businesses most people don't want in their communities, but many East St. Louis area politicians have embraced them. Friday night in the Hustler Club. The multi-million-dollar operation is part of the biggest industry in Washington Park, a poor village just north of East St. Louis. There are 10 strip clubs here, one for every 500 residents.
The community has embraced us and specifically the leaders of this community.
A decade ago, then Washington Park Mayor Sherman Sorrell and his wife joined Hustler founder Larry Flint for a ribbon cutting ceremony to mark the club's grand opening. 2 months before that ribbon cutting, campaign finance records show the mayor received political contributions of $7,000 from the club that changed its name to Hustler. It was by far his largest campaign contributions. Sorrell declined to be interviewed for this program.
Well, why would we want to be anywhere else?
Inside Hustler, virtually all the employees and customers are white. There's plenty of money, and no one feels neglected. Outside the club, nearly all of the residents are black, many of them are poor, and the village looks largely abandoned. Since the Hustler ribbon cutting, Washington Park has filed for bankruptcy twice. Gambling, strip clubs, and convenient marts and other businesses selling booze seem to drive much of the economy in the East St. Louis area. Some nightclubs stay open until 6 a.m.
I think, to be honest, those are the people that are willing to come here to invest.
Vicki Forby is the executive director of Emerson Park Development, an East St. Louis nonprofit that runs a job training program, a charter school, and has partnered on the development of hundreds of housing units.
Investors are always looking for a return on their investment, and rightly so. And I think that they are afraid to make the investment and take the risk here.
Emerson Park's biggest project was Parsons Place, a partnership with developer McCormick Barron Salazar. Built a decade ago next to the light rail line, Parsons Place now has nearly 400 apartments and a dozen homes. Despite being in a community decimated by poverty, corruption, and violence, Parsons Place inspired a second successful development next to it.
Is there a lot of violence? Yes. Do I focus on that? No. Do I focus on the corruption? No. Do I focus on the negative? No. If I did all of those things, I'd be like those investors, and I'd leave.
There are serious investors in East St. Louis, but many of them aren't serious about developing their property. A News 4 investigation found that much of the vacant land and housing is owned by speculators who don't live in East St. Louis. One by one, some of the worst-looking real estate in St. Clair County is sold to the highest bidder. This auction features property taken from previous owners who didn't pay their taxes. 5 years ago, we watched as two guys from the Chicago area bought land in East St. Louis at a faster rate than anyone could remember. Now the three companies based out of this small home in Skokie, Illinois, own nearly 800 pieces of property, hundreds more than the next largest private landowner.
The area looks pretty good right now.
AJ Baba, who refused to name his investors during our interview 5 years ago, was the only publicly identified company official. He admitted that he planned to do nothing with the property.
You know what the problem with a lot of the stuff that goes on? Sometimes you build something, they destroy it. You gotta wait for some positive aspect.
Speculators have also tied up much of the property on the underdeveloped East St. Louis riverfront, possibly the most prized land in the Metro East. Although city leaders have often talked about ambitious plans for this area, those plans often failed partly because there was never a unanimous agreement on how to develop it.
Sometimes it feels like it's a fight to make things happen.
In other words, East St. Louis is often its own worst enemy, and it's been like that for a very long time. Nearly a century ago, the city was the scene of the worst race riot in American history. Perhaps as many as 200 blacks were killed. Thousands were left homeless as whites attacked African Americans for taking jobs they felt belonged to them. During the first 30 years after World War II, the East St. Louis area lost tens of thousands of jobs as employers moved to less expensive places to conduct business. And in the late 60s, 70s, and 80s, thousands of whites left for the suburbs.
Why do you think it changed?
Oh, no, I couldn't explain that to you. I would like to know that myself, why they all ran away.
The white people?
Mm-hmm. They all ran away. Mm-hmm.
How long did it take the white people to leave?
You know, I can't think, not too many years they didn't stay, they left.
Helen Lewis was the first black woman in her Washington Park neighborhood.
I think they didn't want to be around us.
Did you see white people leaving when there was only one or two black people here? Or did it take more black people to come to the neighborhood before the white people left?
Well, when the more black people come in, they left.
That's when the white people left.
Mm-hmm.
So you think that some of the white people thought it was maybe okay for just a few black people to live here,
mm-hmm.
but not a lot of them?
There weren't a lot of them, but a lot of them moved in.
And when more black people moved in, then more white people left?
And more white people left. Hmm.
How did that make you feel when that happened?
Yeah, it was kind of crucial.
Did it hurt?
A little bit.
The so-called white flight left a deep wound for many blacks left behind. But thousands of blacks also moved out of East St. Louis and the surrounding villages.
People chased the money.
Chased the money, absolutely.
And if they could move out and get a better job and buy a better house and put their kids in a better school district, in most cases, didn't they do it?
Wouldn't you?
Absolutely.
Yeah. I think that people are human. And they are going to do what is best for their self-interest first. And I think that's what happened.
Now, according to the latest census figures, 98% of the people living in the East St. Louis area are black. 4 out of 10 East St. Louisans live in poverty, more than triple the state average. Residents here are far less likely to have graduated from college and far more likely to be unemployed. Repeated scandals and criminal prosecutions of public officials have prompted even less confidence among investors who might be willing to conduct business here.
Somewhere we have lost our way when it comes to black leadership in East St. Louis.
Retired nurse Phyllis McReynolds says 6 generations of her family have lived in East St. Louis. She still lives in the city and is a leader at Mount Zion Missionary Baptist, one of the oldest and most active churches in East St. Louis.
Sing and go. That's it. Glory to
her activities and her photo collection are evidence of her commitment to family. Years ago, she wanted to open a family-style restaurant in East St. Louis and tried to get government support, but she says city officials didn't help. And eventually, her dream died.
Never heard from anyone in reference to it. Never got to first base.
Crown Food Marts not only got to first base, they also received millions of dollars in government tax breaks. During repeated visits to those businesses, we noticed that the overwhelming majority of employees are men of Middle Eastern descent, just like the owner who lives in the $700,000 home in West St. Louis County.
How many Arabs do you know live in East St. Louis? And yet they own the businesses. The people who own the businesses don't spend their money in East St. Louis. They take it back to where they live. And then we are allowed to just fall apart.
East St. Louis no longer allows clubs to stay open past 3 a.m., even though the mayor thinks that's a mistake. Mayor Parks insists that the Casino Queen and the Crown Food Marts have been great investments for the city, because they produce millions of dollars in revenue every year. Although he admits Crown hasn't hired enough local residents, especially considering it received massive tax incentives that were made possible by local taxpayers. When we come back, a look at some possible solutions to the enormous challenges in East St. Louis. Problems in East St. Louis can seem overwhelming. In many cases, the keys to finding solutions come by understanding who is there and what they need to be safe and successful.
You ready?
Playing catch with his 2 sons.
Good catch.
Matt Hawkins is doing what so many of us try to do.
All right.
Spend time with our children and plant the seeds that will help them grow into good people who work hard to make their communities a better place.
It is our duty to manage our community, and no one can take that away from us. And we should never turn our back on it, because it is us. And when we accept our responsibility, a beautiful community is almost automatic.
Matt, the president of a nonprofit watchdog group, and his wife Kim, a recruiter for a major bank, are raising their boys in Parsons Place, one of the most successful developments in their hometown of East St. Louis.
There were opportunities to go other places, but my heart was just to come back here and be part of my family and, you know, do my part.
The Hawkins say that part is difficult in a depressed and unstable city where many people feel afraid to challenge authority, especially when they've been led to believe that some of the people in positions of power are their friends.
We have to redefine what a friend means. For me, a friend is a person that understands that Matt Hawkins has been through a lot and he's not going to throw it away for some favor for somebody that's doing wrong.
So what would make things better? Matt Hawkins believes there are too many taxing districts in the East St. Louis area that seem to be designed mainly to provide jobs for politicians and their supporters. If you eliminate what he calls wasteful spending at local townships and the election board, he believes it will reduce the impact of corruption and increase the amount of money available for services like code enforcement and public works.
What is it like to try to fight for the truth in East St. Louis?
It's the hardest fight that you're gonna have.
The challenges seem overwhelming.
How many of your students have been shot and killed?
63.
I was thinking about was death.
I was gonna get shot.
At the Emerson Park School and Job Training Program, students like Rico Perkins.
Can you imagine, before your 14th birthday, you're like, Lord, am I gonna live to see 14? Am I gonna live to see 15?
And Elena Burries try to survive the violence that has devastated the city.
My whole world just came tumbling down right on top of me when they told me they got shot. I just wanted to go and make sure that it wasn't really him. But I knew it was, and I couldn't do nothing about it.
63 since 1994.
Wow.
Yeah. Emerson Park's executive director, Vicki Forby, works with young adult students, many of them committed to turning their lives around and giving back to the community, but often finding little opportunity to work in the city and help rebuild it.
I think people have done what they had to do to survive, and I think people will do that in any part of this world.
And at times, it's a seemingly impossible task.
What was it like to look over your shoulder all the time?
Devastated, scared.
Carl Willis wants to work in construction and eventually own his own company, but he's still in a gang and not ready to leave it because of the loyalty and respect he believes he gets from being a part of it.
I'm gonna leave it one day. I ain't saying now, but one day I am. When the time comes, I'll be ready.
To leave the gang, Carl may have to take a severe beating, or he could be killed.
This was a beautiful community. This can be a beautiful community.
Forby says the time has come to take drastic actions, like closing nightclubs and liquor stores at 10 p.m. and bringing in the National Guard to save a community that has been unable to save itself.
I don't think there's anything wrong with having the National Guard come in. This country doesn't mind invading another country to restore peace and deflect violence and restore government. So why are we afraid to do it here?
There have been dramatic actions taken recently, including police raids on overnight clubs and Crown food marts. The state's attorney charged the Crowns with selling illegal synthetic drugs and other crimes. The nightclubs also face criminal charges. And a regional law enforcement commission has been created to provide oversight of the troubled East St. Louis area police departments and allow communities to use tax money usually set aside for development to help pay for law enforcement.
The triple threats of poverty, violence, and corruption have cast a shadow over these cities for a long, long time. But I believe in the people of East St. Louis. They are fighting not just for their part of the American dream, they are fighting for their lives. And they deserve the best from us as public servants.
Taking back East St. Louis will take much more than late night marches through the John DeShields public housing complex, which prosecutors say has a higher murder rate than Juarez, Mexico, one of the most dangerous cities in Latin America.
It really hurts.
Evidence of systemic neglect is everywhere at the DeShields complex. The federal government failed to provide proper security, and the closed Lincoln High School is now a public disgrace, even a year after the state took control of the school district.
They don't care about the community. They don't care about the people.
Inside the school, more evidence of systemic failure, massive taxpayer waste, and mismanagement. Over the years, our investigations found that the elected school board often chose to spend millions of dollars on jobs for family, friends, and political cronies, instead of hiring more qualified teachers that live in their own community. Now it sits as the latest reminder that something once treasured is now trashed.
Until you understand the tough work of building a community, you cannot really appreciate it. And we want to appreciate our community. We want our community to appreciate us.
The troubled East St. Louis School District, dominated for years by politics, remains one of the biggest obstacles to improving the community. As long as test scores and graduation rates are among the lowest in the state, many experts say the community will continue to struggle and it will be much slower to rebuild. When we come back, the story of little Ike and other children who want more and are willing to work for it. One of my favorite places on earth is an old brick building on the corner of 6th and Summit in East St. Louis. That's where you'll find the Christian Activity Center.
I served on the center's board of directors for 5 years and was even the president. But that was a long time ago, and it's not why we're telling the center's story. You see, I've seen dramatic impact that the CAC has had on hundreds of children, and tonight, you will too. 8-year-old Ike Packer loves to laugh, especially at me.
You know what I'm really afraid of? I'm afraid of spiders.
We met little Ike, as he's called, at the Christian Activity Center, one of the safest places in one of the most dangerous neighborhoods in East St. Louis. It seemed like a good place to talk about our fears.
Do you feel safe walking down the street?
Nope.
Really? What are you afraid of when you walk down the street?
Scared of people chasing me. People be having guns.
Little Ike's fear has deep roots. 2 years ago, his 17-year-old brother Kenny was shot and killed as he walked to school.
What do you want to be when you grow up?
Police.
Really? How come you want to be a policeman?
Because you help save people.
Do you know anybody who needs saving?
My brother, Kenny.
Your brother, Kenny? How does your brother, Kenny, need saving?
Bring him alive again.
How do you help a kid like Ike?
You love him. You support him.
Chet Cantrell has been the executive director of the CAC for more than 20 years.
In all African dialects, just about, the word that translates from love is I see you with my eyes. That's what it means. And so all kids just want to be seen, and they grow and flourish if somebody sees them and sees their potential and speaks that to them.
The CAC has helped thousands of East St. Louis children develop their potential and create a safe environment with rules that hold them accountable for misbehaving. The neighborhood around the CAC is one of the poorest and most violent in the entire St. Louis area. The staff says children who are actively involved in the center's programs are far less likely to join gangs or do illegal drugs, and in many cases, their grades improve dramatically.
Hey, what are you doing?
I don't know. I'm helping you.
Can I help you too?
For 17-year-old Xavier Swope, coming to the CAC as a young boy and now as a part-time worker has given him the opportunity to learn, become more focused, and give back to the community.
My dream, probably to see East St. Louis actually be known for our goodness instead of our bads.
It changed my life. It really did.
Michael Payne, a former CAC kid, helped launch the center's computer lab more than a decade ago. Now he's planning to pursue a PhD in computer science, focusing on facial recognition programs that could help businesses and law enforcement. After getting his doctorate, he'd like to open a network security business in East St. Louis, possibly training and hiring East St. Louis residents.
People need mentors. Whenever you're trying to do something or get somewhere, you need somebody that's been there or at least knows how to get there to be able to help you.
I believe I can fly.
According to the center, children who attend at least 3 days a week have a 97% high school graduation rate, more than double the citywide average. And after graduation, 3 out of 4 CAC kids attend college or a trade school. That's almost 6 times the average for the city as a whole. Michael Payne is only one of many success stories.
I know there's issues, but I try not to see the issues. I try to see how to fix them. You know, a lot of times people go and they see things, well, it's just bad, and this is bad, and this is wrong, and that is wrong, you know. But, you know, what are you actually trying to do to help?
It's the kind of environment designed to support the hardworking families caring for kids like little Ike.
Ike told me he feels safe here.
Yeah.
And that he doesn't always feel safe when he leaves here.
And that's tragic. No kid should be afraid.
Is that little Ike?
We told East St. Louis Police Chief Michael Fleury about little Ike.
I heard you want to be a police officer. You do?
Yes.
Come on, let me show you some. I'm going to show you my car.
And the chief couldn't wait to meet him.
Push that button. Now hit the bottom button. There you go. Hit it again. There you go. And say, test 1, 2.
Test 1, 2.
There you go.
We all have dreams.
You remind me when I was little, too. You look just like me.
It's too late for little Ike's big brother.
So you can be whoever you want to be. Whether it's a police or astronaut, or whatever you want to be, you can be it.
But it's not too late.
Give me a hug there, buddy.
For little Ike.
Our job is to do what we can to let little Ike be somebody one day. He can be whoever he wants to be. Good kid.
You can learn more about the CAC and many other terrific organizations in East St. Louis by going to our website, KMOV.com. Some final thoughts in a moment. Corruption isn't new in East St. Louis. It began many decades ago with crooked white politicians and businessmen. But today, East St. Louis is less than half the size it used to be. And in a community this depressed, corruption takes a much heavier toll. There are no simple answers to the massive problems in East St. Louis, but it will take bold actions that hold people accountable, but still see the dignity and goodness in residents who have never given up. Something that's easy to do when you live in America's war zone. I'm Craig Cheatham. For all of us at News 4, thanks for watching.